Hi friend, my name is Pawan Kumar Tiwari. On the behalf of Engineers Youth of India, I am here to discuss the problem of GATE 2016 EDC and Analog of Electronics and Communication Engineering. First, we have to discuss the weightage of EDC and Analog in GATE 2016. The weightage of EDC in set 1 is 10 marks and set 2 is 6 marks and set 3 is 12 marks. So the EDC weightage of set 2, set 1 and set 3 are here, and the weightage of analog subject in set 1 is 8 marks, and the weightage of analog subject in set 2 is 13 and set 3 is 12 marks. So total weightage of EDC analog in set 1 is 18 marks and set 2 19 marks and set 3 24 marks. So the weightage of EDC and analog is quite large in set 3. On the basis of difficulty levels, as we analyze the question paper of different sets, set 1 and set 2 and set 3, we found that the set 2 is more difficult as compared to set 1 and set 3. We will discuss the EDC and analog question in set 1 and set 2 and set 3. But first we discuss the set 1 problem of EDC and analog in set 1. So we will discuss only question 12, 14 and question number 12, 14 and 38 and 39 and 40, 41 in set 1. We will discuss 12, 14, 38, 39, 40 and 41. Let's come on to the question. Question number 12. In question number 12, we have to identify the which statement is incorrect. As well as question number 12 is based upon the MOSFET metal field effect transistor. In there are four statements P, Q, R and S are given. We have to identify the incorrect statement. Statement P, that as the channel length is reduces, on state current is increases. Yes, this statement P is right, because as the channel length is reduces, the off state current is increases. And statement Q said that as the channel length is reduces, the output resistance is increases. As we know, RDS is directly proportional to L by W. As channel length is reduces, the output resistance of the MOSFET is increases. So statement Q said that the channel length is reduces. As the channel length is reduced, the output resistance is increases. As the channel length is increased, output resistance increases. So statement is correct. Incorrect, because if we decrease the channel length, the output resistance is also decreases. So statement Q is wrong. As statement R said that at the channel length reduces, the threshold voltage remains constant. At the channel length is reduces, the threshold voltage is also reduces. As channel length L is reduces, apply that threshold voltage VT is also reduces, because the effect of the drain and source will come into the channel. So we have to apply less voltage to on the MOSFET. So threshold voltage is reduces. If the channel length is reduced, this is called short channel effect. start channel effect in MOSFET. So statement R is also run, and statement S said that as the channel length reduces, on resistance on current increases. So as we know that current ID is directly proportional to W by L. If the channel length is reduces, then drain current is increases. It means the statement yes is correct. So as per given option, Q and R is incorrect. So option C is correct option in question number 12. Further we move to question number 14 in set 1. In question number 14 is based upon the half open problem. In question number 14, we have to calculate how many times the LED will glow. It is a very conceptual question. If you know the output of the op-amp, easily we can tell that how many times the LED will glow. As per given question, here it is connected the op-amp and input is applied to the non-inverting terminal of the op-amp, and a voltage divider circuit is connected to the inverted terminal of the op-amp. 8k, 12k, and the output of the op-amp is converted to a BJT, and the collector of the BJT is connected with a LED. 10 volt, here it is 100 ohm, here it is 15 kilo ohm. We have to find out the how many times LED will glow. The LED will glow only when the BJT is on. The BJT is on only when the base of the BJT is more as compared to emitter. It means the output of the op-amp is positive, then LED, then BJT will go into the saturation region. In this case, the LED will on. LED is on only when the output of the op-amp, only when the output of op-amp is positive. So first we have to find out the potential at the point A. So potential at the point A, we can easily calculate by using the voltage division method. The potential at point A is equal to 10 into opposite same resistance 2 divided by 2 plus A is equal to 2 volt. It means the output of the op-amp is positive when the input is greater than 2. Output of op-amp equal to positive when V input is greater than 2 volt. As per given of as per the given output waveform, we can find that there are only three conditions which will satisfy our condition. So LED will glow three times. So LED will glow three times. So answer of question number 14 is 3. We will move further to question number 38. In question number 38, we have given a semiconductor bar which is a p-type, and the concentration in the semiconductor bar is non-uniform. We have to find the electric field in the bar because of non-uniform doping. As per given problem, you are given here y-axis is related to the doping concentration, and and x axis related to the displacement, distance or width 1 micrometer and 2 micrometer, and the concentration at the point is 10 power 14 and here concentration is 10 power 16. Your concentration is per centimeter cube. Since the semiconductor bar is non-infinitely doped and there is no potential is applied, no external potential is applied across the semiconductor bar, so the no actual current is flowing in the semiconductor. At equilibrium condition, at equilibrium condition, the net current density generated in the semiconductor bar is zero. The net current density will come on the basis of two factors. First is drift current density, second is diffusion current density. So the net current density in a semiconductor bar is zero. If we put the value of current density, then we find the electric field generated in the semiconductor bar due to the non-uniform doping. We have to rub this. As we know that diffusion current density J diffusion plus J drift is equal to zero. Put the value of J drift and J diffusion. We put the E dP dP of x by dx plus E mu P P of x E of x is equal to zero. After solving the value, E will be cancelled out. We will find that dP of x by dx into dP is equal to mu P E of x into P of x. If we put the dP of its value, E of x remainder will be sent to the other side, dP upon mu of p equal to 1 by p of x dP of x upon dx. We know that the value of dP by mu p by Einstein's relation, which is nothing but is the thermal voltage Vt. As per question, it is given that all the parameters are in log scale. So E is equal to Vt 1 by Na, since P of x is same as donor and acceptor and concentration in p-type semiconductor material. So we have to value put here P of x, then ln of with the Na. Here we put the d Na upon dx. So Vt by dx ln of Na total E of x. put the value of na and dx, vt ln of na, ln of na is given that ln 10 to the power 16 minus 10 to the power 16 minus ln of 10 to the power 14 divided by ln 1 micrometer minus ln 1, not micrometer because you have to find the kilovolt per centimeter, 1 centimeter minus ln of 2 centimeter. After solving this value, we get that total electric field generated due to the non-uniform doping in semiconductor wire is, we have to put the direct answer, 0.0133 kilovolt per centimeter. So we will move to the next question, question number 39. In question number 39, it's a very good question. In question number 39, you will asking that if a semiconductor wire is illuminated with a light, then he will ask the concentration when the light is incident, and after a certain time he will ask the concentration. In question number 39, it is given that a semiconductor wire, n-type semiconductor, is illuminated with a photolight given.